So to kick off with today, we will play a video, and this will give you some sense that we'll then lead in from there into talking with and meeting with and bleating with the famous John Giddings.
People can leave their 52 weeks a year and take 1 week in that year and come down and do what they want to do. Nobody pushing them around, nobody telling them what to do.
Girl, you gotta love your man.
Can you get a world where there's brotherhood, where there's decency, girl, where there's kindness, where there's love?
I am the god of hellfire.
Take him by the hand. Make him understand.
My earliest memory was, I can't remember actually getting there, but I remember coming over the hill and seeing what was supposedly 600,000 other people who liked the same music as me, and I didn't actually know they existed till I got there. So it was a life-changing experience.
People try to put us to death.
Talking about my generation.
Just because it just gave me a meaning in life. It made me think about what I'd like to be involved with and what I'd like to do. And because I wasn't capable of being a musician. I was playing in a band, but I was making it up as I went along, really. And I thought, how'd you get to do this? How'd you get to put this on? To provide entertainment for this many people must be an incredible experience, and it is.
Don't try to dig what we all say.
I remember The Who playing, they were fantastic. Jimi Hendrix, it was incredible to see him, but I'm not sure how good he was. The Doors, he was fresh from that Florida case of exposing himself. Leonard Cohen, I remember Joni Mitchell on the Sunday crying and telling everybody to leave the arena because these people had smashed the fences down and come in for free. Jethro Tull, it was extraordinary. It was everybody you ever wanted to see at that moment in time. I think it was being with people who like the same thing as you do. I think that it gave you a meaning in what you do. It made sense of your life somehow. The Isle of Wight Council decided to restart the festival after 32 years it being banned by an Act of Parliament, which said you couldn't have gatherings of over 5,000 people together on one night. And the Isle of Wight Council asked everybody in the music business to restart the event. Nobody was interested because they thought having a festival on an island you could only get to by ferry, nobody would want to come. And so, because I was there in 1970, I fancied a day out. And when I got there and I got on the ferry, I remembered what it was like and what an incredible experience it was. And I thought, oh, it'd be a laugh to do it.
In the old days, we used to say rock.
It's to provide good musical entertainment for people of different ages, music from past, present, and future, to have fun, to hang out with your friends, have a good time. I think it's somewhere to go for a laugh and an experience for 4 days and enjoy it with other people. The difference between us and the other festivals is we're not running it as a money-making business. The money we earn from it, we plough back into it to make it good fun for the people concerned. You obsess all year round about an audience enjoying themselves. It's not just about the groups and looking after the groups. You've got to look after the audience. So you've got to make it more fun and more entertaining for them.
But if you close your eyes, does it almost feel like nothing changed at all? If you close your eyes,
grew up on groups like Caravan, Procol Harum, and I can put them on at 2-3 o'clock in the afternoon. And people always say to me, who are they? The Zombies. And then they see them and they realize they're real musicians. And then you can book groups that you think are going to happen in the future, like Bastille, Imagine Dragons, Ellie Goulding, Jake Bugg. And then you see it all come good by the time the festival comes round. And it's a combination of all those types of acts.
Thank you, Isle of Wight!
Phonix, Larnix, Super Furries.
We put our hearts and soul into it to make it good fun for people. You know, when we had the Rolling Stones, they weren't going to bring their B stage, but I thought, if I get run over on Monday morning, I need to have brought the B stage to the Isle of Wight, and I pay an extra £100,000 to make it worthwhile for them to play three songs in the middle of the park. And I think the fact we care about it and we're passionate about it, hopefully that comes across to people. Everybody's up for it at the start of the season. Everybody is fresh, even the crew, the catering people. It's a good way to kick it off, definitely. Music, sun, sea, fun, rock and roll. What's happened from the early days is it's now become a full-time job and an obsession for myself and all my staff around, where we've created this event, which is personal to us and means so much. And we just want to prolong it forever and keep the integrity of it.
The sense that you had where you wanted to repeat history and to make the Isle of Wight significant really masks the fact that, aside from the Isle of Wight, as big as it is, and as big a financial commitment as it is, because you take a risk when you put on something like that, where you have to go by ferry from the mainland of the UK to an island, obviously in the summer, works well for as a summer day out, night out, 2 days out. But your career, in fact, is much, much more than that. And in essence, the way that you've developed your career comes from being in the business for many years. Starting off as a musician, that beautiful picture of you with the long hair and your passport photograph that we saw in that clip there. But in essence, when you started in the business, you started as an agent.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the only person in the world that went to university to become a social secretary, because I knew if you became a social sec at university, you could meet people in the music business and transfer from one end of the phone line to the other. So I put my hand over the courses. And I looked at my A-levels, it said English, Geography, History. I lifted it up, it said Philosophy, Sociology. I still don't know what they are, but I got to meet people, agents. People like Rod McSween, Barry Dickens would come down for the weekend, and I blagged my way into it, really. Because when you realise you're incapable of being a musician, but you still want to be around music, that's the best way to get in. At the time it was. In those years, social secretaries all became agents, you know.
Social secretaries were responsible for booking talent into university entertainment programs so that they would effectively be the people that brought bands and entertainment to the colleges and the universities across the UK.
Yeah, we had a hall that held 2,000 people and they were losing a fortune because there's only 3,500 students at the university. And I came up with the genius idea of why don't we actually sell tickets to the general public? And then we sold out. So once you start making money, everybody likes you. And you learn the business. You know, we put on Genesis for £600 and
Procol Harum, and it was great days, but it was a great way to learn with someone else paying for you to be there, really.
Yeah, because today, if you've got to take such risks in putting on entertainment, a lot of bands actually have to pay to play in certain countries where clubs don't necessarily have a policy of paying bands really well. And just in terms of how you're going to grow the talent, when you talk about the headlining talent that we'll speak about shortly in this session, you're working with some of the biggest names in the business. Those big names all had to start in some way through the vision and or the agenting of someone that says, I think the Ramones could work well in that particular small venue.
Well, it's a gamble, isn't it? I mean, groups always want to earn the money. That's first and foremost. But then you have to deliver an audience for them. So nobody will thank you if you've paid them tens of thousands of pounds and the hall is half empty. It's a gamble to make sure you get it right. And developing a group's career is one of the most satisfying things you can do. I remember with The Corrs, they were absolutely meaningless.
Corrs, the Irish group, singing group?
And so I booked Shepherd's Bush Empire, posted it all around London and just gave all the tickets away. So it made it look like they were happening. You know, you have to create a vibe and a vision around someone and come up with ideas for them. I think that's the difference between being a booker and an agent. You have to project ahead. But you're guessing all the time. I mean, you know, we've got it wrong a million times.
And you can't necessarily use your own sense of taste. You can use your own sense of vision of what you think might have some kind of magnetism for an audience.
Yeah, but I remember Rod Smallwood taking me to an Iron Maiden gig at the Swan in Hammersmith, a pub, and I knew they were going to be successful, but I fucking hate heavy metal, and I said I can't be their agent because I'll bury their career in 3 months, you know.
And yet when you went to that pub and you saw the band playing, you had a sense, together with their manager, Rod Smallwood, that's been managing them for nearly 40 years, that that band had something that might connect to that metal audience.
Well, you can tell by the audience reaction. You know, when you see a band going down that well that early in their career, there's something connecting with the audience. I remember when I came to London, I had a flat in West Kensington. I walked across the road into the local pub and there was this group on stage and the singer had a Pink Floyd t-shirt on and he'd written I Hate across the top. I thought, how can you do that to Pink Floyd? That's like sacrilege, right? And he was stubbing live cigarettes out on his arm. And all the audience were jumping up and down like that. And they were called the Sex Pistols. It was really exciting. They, you know, they kind of reinvented the music at that time. They created all these new venues for people to play at. People like the Stranglers, the Clash, the Damned. It was a good time.
And also completely against your original perception of seeing bands that could really play incredibly well, the punk movement was different. And in fact, this picture we have on the screen right now of that little airplane, which became the logo of your company, Solo Agency and Promotions, basically was you flying solo as a thinker, a doer, a builder of entertainment. What made you choose that logo?
Well, not quite. It was because I split up with my partner because he was stealing money from me. And so I decided to call it Solo. Uh-huh. And because it's a musical term, and that's the Spirit of St. Louis, which is the first solo transatlantic flight.
Right. And so that was the spirit that drove you to set this up. And looking at the spirit, this was one of the first bands that you really cognited into and became their agent.
Well, I just thought they were really exciting. I mean, there was something happening at that time. They were touring with Talking Heads, and I worked with Barry Dickens, and he had the relationship with Linda Stein. And he had
Stein was the manager of the Ramones.
She was the manager, and he had no clue what to do with them, really. So I got stuck in and developed them throughout Europe. And the four of them, it was like being hit with a sledgehammer. It was extraordinary, the experience. And there was this great interview. We were up in Edinburgh one night and Johnny was doing an interview on the local radio and they said, what do you think about the Sex Pistols? He said they were still fucking miming in the mirror when we were doing gigs in New York. They were one of my favourite groups of all time.
How did you relate to the fact that if they played at 100 miles an hour and songs that lasted for less than 2 minutes, didn't that run counter to your thinking of what great musicianship was?
But it was the vibe that came across from it, really. I'll never forget Dee Dee in one of the few moments of
Dee Dee
when he
Ramone.
Came across Dee Dee, the bass player, when he was being normal for a split second. He said, how were we tonight? I said, what do you mean? He said, were we fast enough? I said, yeah, I think so. I said, why? He said, well, you know, it's a bit hard on your CV to put punk rocker. What's that going to get me? Job selling papers on the Brooklyn Bridge. I thought, fuck me, he's actually thought about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a magic moment, actually.
That's interesting. It's that same sensibility that got Seymour Stein to sign them to Sire and Seymour's late wife, Linda Stein, to manage them, because there was some incredible energy that they encapsulated of that time.
Yeah, and the same thing happened in the early days with Pink Floyd, The Who, Led Zeppelin. I saw Led Zeppelin in the back room of a pub. It said the New Yardbirds. And weirdly, we always just sit down at gigs. So the group had to walk through us to get onto the stage. And Jimmy Page dropped his bottleneck and it went up my flared jeans. So he had to bend down and ask me for his bottleneck back. And so the next day at school, I was the man because Jimmy Page spoke to me.
Incredible. So here's someone that you had a long relationship with, David Bowie. There he is at Wembley Stadium. Tell us a little bit about how you got connected with Bowie.
I got connected through Arthur Fogel, actually, when Wayne Forte was the agent at the time. And when I went on my own, I decided if you're ever going to make it internationally, you need to plug into an American business because England isn't good enough on its own. So Wayne had the agency ITG in New York, so I sold him half of my company. It became Solo ITG. And he looked after The Cure, Depeche Mode, Genesis, Phil Collins, David. And he phoned me up one day and he said, can you book Wembley for me? So I booked Wembley Arena and then I sent him the costing. And he phoned me up and said, no, you idiot, I'm in Wembley Stadium. I nearly wet myself. I went up there and I stood at the top of that stadium and my legs were literally shaking because I'd never done a stadium show in my life. But after 5 minutes, it's just another gig, really, isn't it?
It is another gig.
Just more people.
But in terms of the relationship with David, and also you'd mentioned Arthur Fogel, those of you here in the audience that do not know who Arthur is a Canadian, originally from Ottawa. We'll talk a little bit more about Arthur in a minute. But you once had the great benefit of taking David Bowie to Russia and to Moscow.
Yeah, I booked him in the Kremlin Palace. It was 5,000 people. It was a great gig, actually. The audience went crazy. So I walked backstage, me and Arthur, and we thought, you know, we're going to get accolades, he's going to love us, we're geniuses. And he was going berserk. And I said, what's up? And he said, because the deal I'd done was they could film the show in Moscow TV in return for advertising the show in advance. And I didn't realise, because I didn't go down the front two rows had sat with their fingers in their ears, all the rich people, the dignitaries. He said, it's going to look terrible on TV. So we didn't know what to do, so we came up with this plot that we would go to the TV people and tell them that David wanted to edit the film himself. Completely made up. And they said, okay, that's a great idea, but you've got to go to the TV studio to collect it. So we got in the back of this Trabant or something, drove halfway across Moscow, and we drove up out the back of this studio in some deserted alleyway with no lights, and there was a dead cat in the gutter. And Arthur turned around and said, have you got your passport with you? And I said, no, why? He said, because when they find our bodies, they want to know who we are. I know, the things we do for pop music, eh? Anyway, we got the film, took it back, and unbelievably, David actually edited it and gave it back.
Edited the film?
He edited the film, gave it back.
So when you interacted with him, he had so much of his own artistic self-confidence. What kind of discussions would you have with him about his, not his performance, because he was self-contained, but what kind of dialogue would you have with someone like Bowie during the time you worked with him?
We used to talk about the set list, what he thought would go down well with different audiences in different places, the venues he wanted to play. You know, there was one time when he didn't want to tour unless he had a decent special guest, like we had Morrissey on one tour and stuff like that, and Nine Inch Nails, I remember, we had The Prodigy. He was, when I grew up, and I watched him on Top of the Pops, I thought his mum made all those outfits. I didn't realise it was like some special Japanese designer and he was the cutting edge of fashion, film, the whole thing that went with it. He's the only artist I've ever represented that I've actually wanted to ask for his autograph. I was always shocked when he asked me my opinion.
Is that right? And he did do that because he still wanted to be able to get a sense of how he positioned his art.
Yeah, because they're all in this bubble where they're in a recording studio for a long period of time, and they lose track of what's going on in the real world, really. So they always want to engage, and him and Jagger always have nicknames for each other, call each other the Dame, and what's the Dame been up to, and all that kind of stuff. In the same way that U2 and the Rolling Stones compete with each other for the bigger production and what's going to be, you know, it goes from one step to the next, doesn't it? They always want to outdo each other. I remember when we put U2 on at the Astoria, and Jagger was in the audience, Bono came on stage and said, "We've come to take back the crown."
He did said that
to him? Yeah, pointed at him and said, "We've come to take back the crown."
Of course, there was that tension that they like to engender.
U2 are a folk group, aren't they? And the Rolling Stones are a blues band, so you can't compare the two, really.
Right, no, you can't.
Two different genres.
Right, exactly. But just getting back to Bowie before we go on to the next thing, is that he was so self-contained, was always someone who really had this vision for the future of his art in a way that very few bands that you worked with at that time did.
Yeah, he was always talking about what he was going to do next. And I remember we did a drums and bass tour, which was really boring, actually. And then he just came up with different ideas each time to keep himself interested and involved. And we did Tin Machine. Do you remember Tin Machine?
Sure.
Which is essentially the Iggy Pop band with David singing, really.
Right.
And we were doing Wolverhampton Civic Hall, which is Wolverhampton.
Small.
Yeah, it's a tiny place, but it's also out of the way. It's like bumfuck nowhere.
It's where Ozzy Osbourne comes from.
Yes, that's right. That's living proof, you see. And then I watched the sound check, and I went to David and I said, "I think you should turn down a bit because all these women are going to come and dance around their handbags and they want to see David Bowie." He went, "You're the only promoter that's ever asked me to turn down before I've been on stage." It was great. He had a great sense of humour, actually. I miss him.
His real name was David Jones, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, that's right. From Bromley Arts Centre.
Amazing. So let's have a look at this. This is another legendary group from a long time ago, but this is taken just a couple of years ago when they were a huge success for you at the Isle of Wight. There they are.
Yeah, I can't believe they did it, actually. I think I bribed them with the helicopters because they said, "How are we going to get there? We're playing in London the next day," and all that kind of stuff. I said, "I'll get you there. I'll make it happen." And I had a friend who had these huge Sikorsky helicopters, so I talked him into flying them down. But it's so funny because they did a runner and they all have their each individual vans because they don't talk to each other. And
yeah, that's true. They do not really communicate with each other other than playing on stage together.
You wouldn't go in individual vans if you were all big friends, would you?
No, really? No, that's true.
But what happened was Mick Fleetwood had such a good time, he came back on stage to thank the audience, and the rest of them left without him. So this whole, and his driver didn't know where the helicopter was parked, so he had to come back in. He was like amongst 50,000 people trying to find his way through. Fleetwood was going bonkers. It was a great night, though.
That was it there. That was them actually on stage at the Isle of Wight. And that particular performance won a huge headline award for being a really remarkable performance drawn from a big international competition.
I don't think they've played a festival since like 1969 or something.
Huh.
I don't remember them ever headlining a major festival in the UK. It was a great night, but the problem is, when you have someone like that, such a great band, you stand there watching the whole performance thinking, well, who the hell am I going to get next year who's got that many hits and going to go down that well? So I finally got persuaded to book Queen with Adam Lambert because I always thought it was a bit Nancy having another singer. But they were stunning. I mean, anybody who hasn't seen Queen
voice
with Adam Lambert should go and see them.
He's good. So this year for Isle of Wight, who are your headliners and who are the acts that you are seeing in the slipstream of some of these historical great headliners?
The Friday night is Run DMC and David Guetta. Saturday night is Arcade Fire and Catfish and the Bottlemen.
Arcade Fire, Canadian.
Part of the Canadian Mafia. And Sunday night we've got Rod Stewart.
Great. So
maybe with the Faces, who knows.
And so people would come and basically stay there for 3 days to
4 days because the campsite opens Thursday at lunchtime. And my campsite manager said to me, "Do you realise you've got 30,000 people here by Thursday lunchtime?" So I thought, open up the bars, because you don't want people going into town and buying beer and bringing it back. You want them to buy your beer.
Of course, exactly.
It's all about the food and drink.
Amazing. So you mentioned Arthur Fogel. There's Arthur right there. He was on a stage similar to this, and he's a good friend of yours, Arthur. And
yeah, I mean, we've grown up together in the business. We've
and
had
he's
a lot
being
of fun
honored
together.
Tonight by being inducted into the Canadian Music Hall of Fame.
Oh, is that what he's getting? I didn't know what it was. Okay.
Yeah, no, it's a really wonderful honor for him. And the two of you have worked together with this young woman.
Yeah, well, she came to us because we did the Stones, and you two came to us because they lost money on their tour and they wanted to make money on their tour. And then she saw that we were doing those two major tours, so we automatically took her on. And
You did the Sticky and Sweet tour with her, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I think I've done about five tours. I can't remember what they're all called. But we've done the four biggest grossing tours of all time, which I'm proud of.
So which ones would those have been?
Stones, U2 and Madonna. Stones is two of them, I think, or U2 is two of them, I can't remember.
Right, no, certainly Sticky and Sweet was nearly $300 million. Yeah. The U2 was nearly $800 million.
Jesus.
And I mean, this is incredible money. When you used to go to these small venues in Wolverhampton, as you said, and here you are with others that are just huge grosses, like it is, like Coachella is a big gross, and of course the one in September, October last year.
The Desert Trip, but they're not doing it again this year because they told everybody how much money they made, and all the groups won 10 times more this time. So.
Of course, because they grossed $191 exactly. million. Dollars. Yeah.
So I think everybody worked out they should have got more.
So here's another picture of Madonna. And of course, you work closely with Guy O'Seary, her manager, because you have to go through details with them and with Arthur, just combining together to make sure that everything goes well. Do you do all of Europe and the UK?
Yeah, I do the whole of... I'm the European promoter. And sometimes I get involved in South Africa, Istanbul, Tel Aviv, all that kind of stuff. It depends what job needs doing, really. But it takes 18 months to plan this kind of tour that far in advance to make it all happen properly. Because when you're booking stadiums, it's not just the one night. You get five nights set up and two nights to take it all out. So you're booking it for a week and there's all these football games going on. And you have to move everything around. It's like being in the army, really. There's 200 trucks crisscrossing Europe. And you've got to make sure everybody can get to the right place at the right time. It's a very efficient, you know, people think the music business is full of drink and drugs, but there are all these people out there doing all this hard work, turning up with all this equipment every day. It's effectively making a building site. I really admire them, because we swan in at the last minute and take all the glory.
So the point is, you have to have really sophisticated logistics that pull all of this together, which is what makes Live Nation a successful company, being able to do 25,000 gigs or productions a year, or certainly when it comes to these big festival dates, as you are now used to. Like when you talk about Istanbul as an example, you do have to work with someone locally because the language difficulties in Turkey, but these are all things that you have to put into your quiver to be able to produce a decent show.
Yeah, depending on which city you go to, they're all different, but you have to worry about security in places like that.
And more so today.
Yeah, more so today. I mean, anywhere you go in Europe, you know, we never thought it would happen to the music business, but you saw what happened last year. So on the Iggy Pop tour last summer, the post-pop depression, we had an advanced security team because everybody was so paranoid about what was going to happen at one of the shows.
So the advanced security team would go to the venues ahead of you even doing the setup,
yeah,
just
absolutely.
To make sure that you cleared the site, it was checked and all of that.
Yeah, it wasn't a cheap hobby. But I think, you know, if somebody's going to come in with a gun, it's pretty hard to stop them,
to be perfectly frank. Exactly. So there you are, very healthy looking bloke, actually.
Yeah, you get a suntan when you stand for 2 weeks in a field. Get burned.
And so that's the field where you actually set up the Isle of Wight Festival.
Yeah, that is the field. That is Seaclose Park, it's called, which for 50 weeks of the year is football pitches for children. It's incredible when it all gets built and you see this whole city being built around it. It's an extraordinary experience. There's nothing more satisfying than seeing 50,000 people in a field going down a storm to whatever band is on. Because people always ask me who my favourite artist is. And I always watch how the audience react to it as opposed to watching the artist's performance. I never thought that Jay-Z could get the audience higher and higher until Kanye West came on with him. And it, like, a shiver went up my spine. It was extraordinary.
Incredible. So the Rolling Stones obviously played at the Isle of Wight, and you've also had the Stones playing across Europe as well.
Yeah, they're an interesting bunch of chaps, really. I mean, it's like a corporate structure touring the world. I think Mick Jagger is the best manager of any rock band in the world. He's kept that band alive without a hit for how long? You know, they've just had a hit with the album, but it's extraordinary the way he's kept the brand going.
An incredible ambition. He's a fitness fanatic. The band's been going for over 50 years. Here's one of you with Prince. Not Prince, the late Prince, but the Prince. And also I see that you've got Rag and Bone Man playing in the Isle of Wight.
Yeah, well, I made that story up. That picture is from 9 months ago when we did Lady Gaga and Tony Bennett at the Royal Albert Hall for Well Child. And I just put the picture on the internet and said that the Prince was saying to me, can you book Rag and Bone Man for the Isle of Wight Festival? And the newspapers pick it up. I didn't realise, till I joined the music business, that clowns like me make up the stories. I always thought what was in newspapers was true.
So you really are one of the great architects of fake news.
Not wars, though.
Not wars. No, but very, very good. But anyway, it's good to see you there with the Prince. Here's All Right on the night, on the day at the Isle of Wight. Just look at that audience digging it, digging the scene.
You need to realise the festival is actually a hobby. I do have a real job.
Which is?
Which is I book groups, I'm an agent for groups, and I do Live Nation global touring with Arthur. John Reed's sitting over there.
Where's John Reed? Is he here in the audience?
He's probably left by now because he's bored. But, you know, I don't like gardening, I don't like golf. I couldn't think of anything better to do than starting a festival. And it's the most fun you can ever have. It's like being a child again when you have a fort or a farm and you place things around. Because you can move everything around. And when you're doing a stadium tour, the group tell you what to do. They tell you what stage they're going to have, what the pass system is. When you promote a festival, you can do what you like. And you invite you pay the bands you love far too much money to come and play in a field and then invite your mates. That's what it boils down to. And you pray that the sun shines.
Of course, that's always the prayer. But here's Macca, Paul McCartney, who played at the Isle of Wight. What was he like to work with? And do you have to bite your fingernails when he's around, or think of other things for fingernails?
Yeah, he was all right, actually. It was quite interesting, because on the Sunday morning, I think I was slightly hungover, and I'm standing in the middle of the field. I got a phone call from Barry Marshall, who represents Paul, and I had Pink supporting Paul McCartney. And he said, have you got anyone that can do acrylic nails? And I thought, what are acrylic nails? I have no clue what you're talking about. I thought, they're just winding me up. They're bored on the ferry. They thought, let's phone up John, ask something stupid, like ask for an elephant or whatever on the Isle of Wight. But I went and asked one of my concessionaires, and she said, I know what they are, but we don't have the kit to do it with. And so I got the yellow pages, and I phoned up a young lady in Cowes. There's a city town on the Isle of Wight called Cowes, unbelievably. And she came along with this little vanity case and sat there for 2 hours and waited for the entourage to roll in. And it was actually for Paul McCartney himself, because he strengthens his fingernails when he plays the acoustic guitar on Yesterday.
Huh.
Yeah, and he was so nice, he actually had dinner with her.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So that's the job of the promoter, is to anticipate everything. Someone looking for someone who can do acrylic nails, because Paul McCartney needs to strengthen his nails to play Yesterday acoustically to the audience.
Yeah, if you want acrylic nails, come to me.
Incredible.
Definitely.
Now, here's an interesting group. How many of you here in the audience are familiar with Little Mix? Not many. Well, you should be, because Little Mix... From someone, John, you promoted the Spice Girls at their height, didn't you?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, they're the biggest girl group since the Spice Girls. We sold 500,000 tickets in the UK alone this year. We sold out 35 arenas, 20 open-air shows. They're supporting Ariana Grande at the moment in North America. But they define the rule of pop music, because normally you get one big album and it goes down, but they're on their fourth album and it's still going up and up. We're breaking in Australia, Japan. It's fantastic. And they still talk to each other, which also defies girl group rules.
So when you were involved with the Spice Girls in the very height of the Spice Girls nearly 20 years ago, amazing to even think about that, when you first saw or heard Little Mix, they were really nothing. They were appearing on a TV show, which was Simon Cowell's...
they were put together on The X Factor. They just picked four random girls and said, we're going to make a group from you.
And when did you actually get to see or hear about them? Did you see them on TV?
I saw them on TV, yeah, and then I went to see them at Wembley Arena. And I don't know, they were good. and you could see the kids' reaction to them. And there's nothing more exciting than doing a pop tour when you come into an arena and everybody's screaming their heads off. We're at Westlife or Boyzone. It's extraordinary. And they, you know, when you talk to them, they're older than, they're more mature than their years. They want to be successful. Being a pop star is not just about performing on stage. You have to work hard at being successful all the time and work in the room. And pop stars work a lot harder than rock bands, actually. They're much more grateful for the audience that have given them that time and the meet and greets and all that kind of stuff.
Now, they're also managed by the same management company that manages One Direction, Harry Styles. So clearly, they had an understanding as to how the star-making machinery of the pop world worked. But give us some sense. Did you go to the managers, Richard Griffiths and Harry McGee, and say to them, I believe in this act. I can see that they've got something. I will book them into... How did you do it? How did you set it up?
Yeah, I mean, I went to them and said, can I please be their agent? I'd really like to work with them and help make them successful. And they said, you can't. We've got to deal with CAA. So I blagged them into not letting that group go to CAA because they thought that I was into it that much that I would put my neck on the line to make it happen. But you have to take that gamble, don't you? I'll never forget with them. Remember Big Country?
Big Country.
Big Country. Sure. I booked them on the Reading Festival without telling them. And Stuart went in the paper and said that he wasn't going to be there because he was on holiday. So I phoned him up and said, instead of taking commission, I would pay for him to fly back from Portugal for the day to play the festival. And if an artist hears that from an agent and knows that you believe in them that much, then they're willing to do it. They have to see that you're into it.
Yeah, but that's always been the way you've believed you should be. You believe in an artist, you almost believe you believe in it emotionally as well as professionally.
Well, you've got to. You know, it's not just about making money. If you make the right decisions, the money will come naturally.
Right.
That's the way it works. And you're praying this group, because you like a group, you're praying they're going to be successful. But I mean, I've made a few mistakes as well. I booked the first ever Pretenders gig and didn't go to it. I saw them in rehearsal. They were absolutely dreadful. I thought they're never going to happen. And then my second best one was Culture Club when Virgin Records sent me, Do You Really Want to Hurt Me? And I thought that was crap. And my third one, which was the biggest one actually, but I don't know how much anybody knows about them. There's this pop group in England called Take That, a huge place,
Take
stadium.
That, huge act in England.
Yeah, and when they were reforming, the lawyer phoned me up and said, do you want to book them? And I said, is Robbie Williams in the band? He said, no. And I said, no, thanks.
Oh.
Put the phone down and every girl in the office told me I was an idiot. And they were proven right.
You were?
Yeah. Okay. You can't do it all.
So you'd mentioned about the making a good large-scale fan experience, but here's someone you'd had an early belief in who was not successful in a broad international sense before Happy. He was in the band he was...
N.E.R.D.
Exactly. Tell us a little bit about your relationship with Pharrell and Ron Lafitte, his manager.
Well, it was weird because there's, you know, Khalees, Milkshake and all that. I wanted to represent her. So I had a meeting with her in Virgin Records in London, and there's this guy asleep on the sofa behind her, this black guy. So after 10 minutes, I said, who's that? And she said, he's called Pharrell Williams. He wrote and produced the album. He's going to be really famous. So eventually when he woke up, I introduced myself. And he said, what do you do? And I said, I'm an agent. I book gigs. He said, oh, we'd like to do some gigs in Europe. And the reason we got on was because in America, you have to play with either Jay-Z or Kanye West. I put N.E.R.D. on with the Foo Fighters, with David Bowie, because to me, they're a rock band, they're rock stars. And he came up to me one day and he said, can I have a word? I said, what? He said, who else have you got in your hip-hop division? And I said, have you got a mirror? He said, what do you mean? I said, well, I don't even know what hip-hop is. And then it kind of... I mean, I love him. He's one of the nicest guys in the world, but it's funny how people go in and out of fashion. When there was this girl group called Parade, and I suggested to Warner Brothers that Pharrell wrote and produced the album, and they said to me, no, he's all over. And then 3 months later, Happy comes out, and it's all in the ascendancy again.
Incredible.
He deserves all the success he gets in life.
Incredible. And even the story of Happy, the song, it took a rewrite four different times before it was actually used in the movie that then happened. So let's have a look. You've done stuff with Rihanna, and in fact you have a great distinction in that you, in terms of Europe International, produced the five biggest female acts in the world. Here's one of them.
Madonna, Beyoncé, Lady Gaga.
Of course, Celine.
Fantastic. You 20 years later.
You've got great respect for her.
I'd like to say that I was a great A&R man, but the truth was, it was when I went to Toronto to... we're in Toronto. I came to Toronto to sit down in a meeting to represent the Rolling Stones, and I came out of the meeting having been appointed, and I thought, right, let's go and get drunk and celebrate. And they said, can you come and hear this girl sing? And I thought, I don't want to go and hear a girl sing. I can't imagine anything more boring. But I had to go and be polite. So they gave me a ticket in the fourth row of this 500-seat theatre, and this woman came on and sang, and she was obviously very good, but it wasn't really my cup of tea. But I went backstage afterwards, and they were so nice. The people were incredible. And they said, do you think you can get us a gig in London? And because they were nice, I booked the show. And then 3 years later, she was headlining two nights at Wembley Stadium.
Incredible. Here's a story, of course,
luck.
Thanks to Arthur Fogel, and you worked closely with Arthur, to bring Beyoncé to Europe.
I know. She is a true... Her performances are extraordinary. The amount of effort and time she puts into it. I mean, I don't think people realise how hard these people work at doing this. Like Madonna does a full run-through at an open-air show before the gates open. She works those people tirelessly to get it inch perfect. It's extraordinary. And I really admire them for it.
And tell us a little bit about the relationship with Queen Bey.
Distant. No, I mean, there's so many people involved in these huge stadium tours.
Right.
You don't sit down with Beyoncé and plan it in the same way you would have done with the Stones or U2 or David Bowie. They have set ideas, and the biggest problem is they come up with these ideas for a stage show, and you think, how the hell are we going to put that into this stadium?
Right.
You know, they get bigger and bigger all the time.
But in the case of someone like Beyoncé being really probably the most significant female artist in the world today, tickets go on sale.
Don't tell Madonna that.
No, don't tell Madonna that.
Okay.
But tickets go on sale and they go clean literally within a few minutes because of computerized ticketing.
Yeah, I mean, it's huge. It was gangbusters, absolute gangbusters. But you never really know. You're praying. I told someone the other day that they were crazy for gambling on horses. And they said, but you gamble on people with two legs every day. And I thought, you're right. Never really occurred to me.
And you spoke about Little Mix and obviously the relationship with Celine Dion. One of the interesting stories about Celine, and maybe this is a reflection of Canadian manners and Canadian the way that Canadians work. Celine Dion is one of the few artists that has come to you to find out whether you made enough money as a promoter on her tour.
Yeah, that's right.
Tell us the story.
In Edinburgh, I was walking past the dressing room after soundcheck, and she said, Jean, can I have a word? And I thought, oh God, what have I done now? So I went into the dressing room, and she goes, how have we done tonight? I said, well, put it this way, you sold more tickets than the Rolling Stones or U2 at a higher ticket price. She said, you must be a good promoter. I said, well, actually, it's not my name on the poster. And then she said the classic, which I've never heard from anybody else in my life, are you making enough money?
Incredible.
Yeah, that's quite nice.
So you still like Celine Dion?
I said, no, I didn't.
So as we come towards the closing moments of this session, this is a show that's now on sale. A big show in Hyde Park in London coming up soon. And it's Phil Collins, and this is a very important tour for Phil Collins. And it's a big, big selling tour.
Yeah, well, it's his comeback, isn't it? You know, the last tour we did 12 years ago was called the First Final Farewell Tour. And I think all pop stars, they want to do it again sometime. And their children are older, like Phil's got his son drumming in the band, for example, and they just want to come out again. They realise, I mean, Pharrell loves Phil Collins. People really respect him as a singer-songwriter. And because of the gap, nobody's seen him in the last 12 years. We sold out 60,000 tickets in Hyde Park, sold out five Albert Halls in 10 minutes. We're doing five nights at Cologne Arena, five nights at Paris. So he's putting his toe in the water. And if it works, then he'll go further afield.
How's his hearing?
Pardon? I don't know.
But he's doing...
Yeah, well, he heard one and I said hello to him.
So. He does. How much am I getting? He hears that.
Yeah, how much?
Okay, here's... this is something that you're also doing, very interesting, again, working together with Arthur Fogel at Live Nation and the linkage with that, but you promoting U2, in fact, you've got some big stadium shows coming up with them?
Yeah, we've got 15 shows to the 30-year anniversary of the Joshua Tree. But I think, you know, if we couldn't sell out 15 stadiums on the Joshua Tree, we should all give up and go home. Right. It's one of the most iconic albums of all time. And to their credit, they're going to perform it all the way through.
What
I've
are they
seen
like?
The stage set. It's quite exciting.
What are they like to work with?
Irish people really have their feet on the ground. Every Irish client I've ever worked with, they say please and thank you. They'll walk across a room to say hello to you. They're no different from when they were playing the Hope and Anchor in Islington. You know, they're not big time, but they're real artists. They're obsessed by getting their music right and playing to the right audience and the way they're perceived.
Incredible. So you've had a long relationship with them now. And even though people were surprised that they would be going back to do Joshua Tree rather than something new, they also do understand that their legacy is so rich. People do want to experience the Joshua Tree again. It's part of people's emotional memory bank.
Well, it's funny when artists want to keep themselves motivated and perform new songs and all that, but the truth is the audience always want the old songs, so you have to do a combination of both to keep it going.
Right.
You know, when you two were playing Glastonbury, I sent an email to Paul McGuinness saying, with all due respect...
The manager. He was the manager at the time.
So with all due respect, if you open with six new tracks from the new album, you're going to lose the audience. I said, you've got to make sure it's a greatest hits audience because it's not necessarily your audience. And he sent my email to every member of the band. I thought, oh, shit, I'm going to get fired. And to his credit, Adam came back and said...
Adam Clayton, the bass player.
I agree. So, I mean, they've got their head screwed on. They really know what they're doing.
And nice guys to work with.
Yeah, great.
So here to end our session, here's a picture of four gentlemen on your left. Is John Reed. Is John Reed still here in the audience? There he is, that gentleman. You can see the very handsome guy on the left. He's sitting there in the front row, a wonderful executive who really understands entertainment. It runs through his bloodstream. He's Northern Irish, which is not Irish, but he's there. Then there's Arthur Fogel next to him. You there in the middle, good-looking bloke in that leather jacket.
I have the same jacket on in every picture.
Oh, no, you've got it. Who's your tailor?
I've obviously only got one.
And then the fellow on the right of that picture is Brian Seller, who was the tour manager for U2.
He was more than the tour manager. He was like the right-hand man of Paul McGuinness.
He was.
He implemented everything. I mean, those bands, they have big entourages who make things happen.
Right. So that gives you some sense. And there's Arthur, your bosom buddy, and certainly partner in grime and crime.
Definitely partner in crime.
Partner in crime and one of the most wonderful, amazing executives in the business, a real fantastic visionary from Ottawa, who's now become, he is really, one of the greatest entrepreneurs in show business that we've seen certainly in the last
few
years.
Yeah, he's helped create the modern music touring
business.
No
question.
Absolutely.
Incredible guy. Same can be said for John Reed, is a really good bloke. And with that, John, thank you so much for coming to Toronto, being part of Canadian Music Week, hearing your stories. I know we've barely scratched the surface of the surface. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a big round of applause to John Giddings,
one
of the great professionals in our business. Thank you, John.